Imagine a world where everything you see is filtered, designed specifically to your unique preferences, evolving intuitively to your desires before they even form in your own mind.
Or a world where you can be anywhere, anyone, without leaving your bedroom.
Well, what if this world sucks?
Oh my God.
Are we going to be able to live without these devices? How is this going to change how we experience space? And how will these virtual dimensions affect our physical world? A portion of this video is sponsored by Wayfair. Virtual reality is the promise of a fully immersive, interconnected universe that transcends physical limitations. A world unbound by gravity, material limitations, or cost. Sounds kind of like the dream, right? Augmented reality is even more interesting because it can enhance our physical world by overlaying digital information and objects on top of our real world. Both of these could completely transform all areas of life, including how we use our environments. Now, we can all be in the same space, but have a completely subjective experience of that space. But why does all of this still feel so far from reality? Public transit is this unique in-between space, where we can physically exist in a communal space, but mentally be immersed in our personal world. It's also a universal experience, so it's kind of the best way to observe cultural changes. But there's something about this image that's a little bit unsettling. And it might have something to do with ambiguity. According to Claude Levi-Strauss, the facial disguise temporarily eliminates from social intercourse the part of the body which reveals personal feelings and attitudes. The reason why masks can be creepy, even if it's neutral or happy, might have something to do with the fact that it hides the emotions or intentions of the person underneath. I don't know if this person is crying or glaring at me. And this weird psychological phenomenon might be why Apple spent millions of dollars developing this feature called EyeSight, which at first seems like a completely useless feature. It basically allows people to see an actual live simulation of your eyes with data from the internal infrared cameras, two per eye, to capture your eye movement and facial expressions. The data is then fed to a machine learning algorithm that combines it with your own unique digital persona using the front-facing true-depth camera. All of this tech and R&D, just so that you can see if somebody's looking directly at you or if they're immersed in their VR space. And this connection between what's happening behind your glasses and your surroundings could be one of the key steps to mass adoption. And as we get more comfortable wearing these devices, it's going to unlock a whole new world that straddles between the physical and the digital. Historically, architecture used programming diagrams to define distinct, separate spaces. As we get into more postmodern architecture, we start to get a bleeding of different programs, creating these in-between spaces. VR and AR allow us to merge all of this and create multiple spaces within one physical space. And not just that, each person could have a totally different experience of that space. Basically, everything we know about three-dimensional space goes out the door, and we get what Matsuda calls the subjective space, where everyone can be in the same environment and experience different realities. Someone sitting just next to you on the bus will see a completely different city curated to their personal tastes and interests. You can be in your digital bedroom while you're physically in a cubicle or an airplane or a prison cell. You can also be in a museum or a concert hall or an aquarium or a basketball court or a pool or a school or a library. There's something fundamentally human about wanting to share a communal physical experience with other people. Studies have found that going through a shared experience, just by being in the same space, can intensify that experience, even if there's no verbal exchange, and even if it's just with strangers. In this one study from Yale University, students were given chocolates, either simultaneously with another participant or alone. Despite both chocolates being identical, students reported the chocolates tasting better when they ate it with the other person in the room. And that's why, even if we don't need to, we like going to a library or a coffee shop. We like being in the same space and the presence of other people. These are some of the moments from the Lightship Summit Conference in 2022. The graphics are still kind of at a rudimentary level, but it's an example of how virtual content could mesh with the physical world. The goal was to create a local experience that could only exist in this specific location. And in order to do this, they overlay the virtual space on top of the existing space using traditional architectural techniques like plans, sections, 3D modeling, as well as new VR tools to draw these cute little elements that interact with the people and the space. And the result is a spatial experience where the digital fabric is woven into the architecture of this conference venue. Most of this is experienced through the phone, like this. But once headsets become a part of our daily routines, we're gonna have a much more seamless, immersive experience. So I think rather than subjective space, maybe brick and mortar stores are gonna try to capitalize on this innate desire to be in the same space and try to create a hyper-local experience that can only be experienced at their stores. We've seen how stores have transformed since the rise of Instagram, with more and more of these themed stores popping up. Maybe we'll be seeing an amplified version of this, where stores combine AR and their physical space to create a unique experience that you can't replicate anywhere else. What is this? Ah! It's time to talk about Wayfair. You probably know of Wayfair as a website where you can buy affordable and chic furniture. But did you know that they also have an educational YouTube channel? A Style is Born is their new series where they discuss how and why certain styles came to be. It's really well produced, really well researched, and I love how they break down the history of that style from the social and economic conditions and why it's making a comeback. And I think when you understand the context behind something, you can really appreciate it a lot more beyond just the aesthetics of it. Anyways, I would highly recommend you check out their episode on how brutalism influenced interior design. I personally love brutalism, but it's also quite controversial. People either love it or hate it. But what's certain is that it's spread all over the world and became a trend in itself. So yeah, check it out and go and subscribe to their channel. I'll include the link in the description. But what happens when we leave the public realm and into our homes? The design of homes can be one of the best ways to observe the changes in culture or lifestyle. It went from this to this to this, as the TVs went from this to this to this. In fact, TV has been the focal point of our living rooms for decades. We orient things around the TV because it's not just entertainment. As weird as it is, it's kind of a passive bonding experience. But what if, and this is a huge what if, TVs become obsolete? Imagine your homes without TVs. Everyone plugs into their own entertainment, or if you want to have a shared viewing experience, plug into a device that syncs all of your movies. We might lay things out specifically for talking or hanging out. Maybe we can bring back conversation pits, which could even be covered when it's not being used, giving you even more space for VR activities. But since this requires more floor space, we can get a rise in modular furniture that could be arranged in multiple ways. Maybe we'll start getting more of this than this. Or we could start to adopt more movable or sliding walls to adjust the space for VR use. Kaichi Matsuda predicts that there's going to be two factions of designers, one that deals with the physical layer and the other on the digital. And since digital design can be much more cost-effective and resource-efficient than constructing physical structures, we can potentially create safer, more accessible, and more aesthetically pleasing spaces with the same budget. This could even prioritize initiatives for street beautification, which often ranks very low in budgetary considerations. Lower-income communities could get the same kind of aesthetic treatment as wealthier neighborhoods. Maybe more green spaces, more architectural diversity, or streets lined with trees. But what about this experience? Being in nature has a whole lot of health benefits. And one of the reasons is because it's a very holistic, multi-sensory experience. In fact, tactile stimulation has been linked to improvements in memory and learning, spatial awareness, and even emotional connection. But most of our current world is created considering only one of the five senses, sight. Yohani Palasma is the author of Eyes of the Skin, also one of my favorite books, and he writes, "The suppression of other sensory realms has led to an impoverishment of our environment, causing a feeling of detachment and alienation. These intangible elements are very easily neglected, especially in the face of rapid change, but these are the things that can enrich our experiences. It's hard for me to not imagine a dystopian future where trees just look like trees, but don't smell or sound or move like them. Or you step into a cabin, but you don't smell the cedar. You can't feel the grains of wood or the concrete on your skin. Maybe we won't even notice what's missing because we forgot what it feels like. Or these real tactile experiences are reserved only for certain people or certain neighborhoods. But what if, instead of creating completely new environments, it's more about filling in the gaps? I'd imagine that filling in a tree between two existing trees would require a lot less computational power than creating it from scratch. But it could also increase the believability of virtual objects by sitting between the real objects. Our brains also have a tendency to fill in the gaps, so it could read the virtual elements as real. It could even apply to architectural details. One of the mandates of modernism, which was a reaction to the Beaux-Arts movement, was to democratize architecture by stripping it of all of its ornaments. Because ornamentation was expensive. But let's be honest, maybe other than architects, I think most people would pick this over this. With AR, we could bring back delicate ornamentation. Maybe it could even change how we detail certain elements to be better equipped for AR. This idea of filling in the gaps, it could even happen at the macro level, at the city scale. In typical city grids, we have our front streets and our back alleys, which are usually the leftover space. Designers have attempted to design the back alleys with not a huge amount of success. But with the help of AR, maybe we can actually design and program the alleys or parking lots with very little cost. And we can actually start to use these leftover spaces. The digital divide suggests that with these new technologies, we're going to see an even bigger gap between the rich and poor. Those who can afford to will have access to more information and also a better spatial experience, where the wealthy can buy spaces with less ads and they're going to have a more comfortable and accessible AR space. But maybe with the right guidance and strategic implementation, we could actually close that gap. And we could use virtual content to increase the aesthetic standards and create environments that are beautiful and inclusive and engaging and layered all at the same time. Right now, a very select few in society shape our environments, just due to the sheer amount of training involved. But in the digital world, where rigorous standards like building codes don't have to apply, it opens the doors for more people from all backgrounds to influence the visual fabric of our communities. But who knows? Maybe our virtual experiences will be so cool that we forget about our physical world altogether. What do you guys think about all these dimensions? Let me know in the comments. Also, we have a Discord community and a newsletter. I'll leave the links in the description. And with that, I'll see you in the next video.
Over here!
You got my attention, baby.